Welcome to our ecumenical Maundy Thursday service together with First Christian Church of Concord, Disciples of Christ, Clayton Valley Presbyterian Church, and East County Shared Ministry, which is comprised of Community Presbyterian Church of Pittsburgh and First Congregational Church of Antioch, UCC. And we're so grateful that you're here participating in our service. We know that some folks are joining us as we move into prelude, but we're preparing our hearts for our time together. So please stay muted until we open for prayer time. We want to thank Dale Scoville, the organist at Clayton Valley Presbyterian Church, and all of our musicians leading tonight for their contributions. That's a sound we love to hear. Thank you, Dale, for sharing your gifts. We are the Progressive Reformed Mainline Protestants in Concord to East County, and we're grateful that you're here with us. We are a people of extravagant welcome, whether we're Presbyterian, Disciples of Christ, or UCC. All of our four congregations are open and affirming, and we love to say, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We have a special program tonight, but we also want to we'll remind you more about what's coming up for Good Friday and Easter later. But one of the new things that the Interfaith Council and ECSM are co-hosting on April 18th is a special day retreat in the afternoon from noon to 3 p.m. with Chief Philip Scott. He did a day retreat with us last year for about 3 hours, a new moon retreat and healing service. And it was just an amazing experience to hear him preach. He will be preaching at ECSM in the morning, but there's a retreat that afternoon. So let us continue to expand our hearts as we sing together, and especially recognizing that the Spirit was here with you. I didn't do anything special to bring it. You didn't do anything else special to bring it except show up. And that Spirit that's with us always encourages us to recognize this spiritual hour that we're about to share together. Let us sing this chant from Phil Porter, a UCC minister, and let us welcome Spirit and recognize Spirit here together. Gathered here in the mystery of this hour, gathered here in one strong body, gathered here in the struggle and the power, Spirit, draw near. Gathered here in the mystery of this hour, gathered here in one strong body, gathered here in the struggle and the power, Spirit, draw near. Gathered here in the mystery of this hour, gathered here in one strong body, gathered here in the struggle and the Spirit, draw near. Spirit, draw near. Spirit, draw near.
Welcome. We have gathered to remember, to commemorate, to reenact Maundy Thursday. We have journeyed through Lent. We were together at the beginning of Lent on Ash Wednesday, and then we gathered on Palm Sunday together again. And so there's a way in which our coming together has marked these moments in time through Lent and now into Holy Week. And on this night, what we commemorate is the extraordinary moment in Jesus' life when he gathered for the last time with his disciples. And during that meal, what he did has been remembered and kept alive through decades and decades and centuries of our church community, that this is the night that Jesus was betrayed. This is the night that he shared the bread and the cup. This is the night that we remember every time we gather for communion, every time we bless bread and juice. It is this night, this moment when Jesus was on the verge of his death. He knew it. The disciples were still confused. The disciples were still unclear. But Jesus knew. And so for him, this night was one of his last opportunities to speak to the disciples, to tell them what was truly most important about his ministry, about their future lives. And there were two things that he did tonight. He washed their feet. And he gave them a new commandment. And those two things blend together with the cup and the bread. And as he washed the disciples' feet, he did so as a servant. And he explained to the disciples that because I have served you, you are to serve each other. And to do this in the name of love. And he gave them the new commandment that they were to love each other, that we are to love each other as Jesus loved them, as Jesus loves us. And so as we enter into this time, let's remember that last meal that Jesus had with the disciples and allow the energy from that time, allow the spirit from that time to bless and inform and challenge us as we gather tonight. We're going to hear music, we're going to hear scripture, we're going to hear monologues. The first monologue actually begins before this night, it's 6 days before, and it's the story of the woman who buys the perfume to anoint Jesus. And her story is significant because as we hear her monologue, she is really wrestling with the choice that she knows Jesus is going to make and she wants him to not go to Jerusalem, to not put himself in danger. And yet she knows that he will follow the path that has been laid before him. And so listen to her story and the tension that she feels as she approaches the end of his life. And then we'll hear a monologue later from Peter in his wonderfully committed, confused mind, how he understands this night and how he understands Jesus. So be open to be surprised by the Spirit, to be blessed by the Spirit tonight, and allow yourself to settle into that place where your mind meets your heart, where your spirit can feel totally free and invited to join you and reveal itself to you. So let us enter into prayer. Holy God, on this night of nights, when we remember that Jesus gathered with his disciples for the Last Supper, when Jesus washed their feet and spoke to them of love, shared the cup and the bread, and was betrayed, may we, as we remember those events, allow ourselves to be blessed, to be opened, to be challenged by this night. May you allow our love to grow deeper. May you strengthen us to be servants. And may you allow us to walk in the path of truth, to follow the path of love as did Jesus, even into those places where we are in danger, even in those places where people may desert us, even in those places where people may betray us. Help us to stay true to your call to us and to your love. For we pray in the name of Jesus our Christ. Amen.
Teach us to fashion lives that listen to this reading from John 12, verse 1 to 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who is about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me."
Yeah, I was in the middle of the marketplace that day, and it hit me like an overwhelming wave of feeling. I loved him so much. It was a love beyond anything I'd ever known. Not romantic, not like a sibling, certainly like family, but he was so much more to me. He was my teacher, my priest. He was our wise one. He was hope itself, not just for the future, but for the present. For the first time in those days before the terrible thing happened, I felt he might not be invincible. He'd told us, he'd warned us. He'd been saying this could happen all along, but I just couldn't imagine it. He was just so eternal, like always present, you know? Like nothing, not even God would dare take him away from any of us. We could tell the tension was building. "I will beg him," I thought, "not to go to Jerusalem. Just go back to Galilee, go to the hills, go to Nazareth, be with your parents, go anywhere but Jerusalem right now." But even as I thought to myself, I knew that he wouldn't go. This was where he was supposed to be, with all those people gathered for Passover. Jerusalem is where he had to be, and I knew he might not ever leave. I suddenly became aware that I was standing still, oblivious to all around me here in this marketplace, and I began to double over with fear. Just as I did, my eyes came to rest on that stall next to my right, ajar. A most beautiful jar of anointing oil. The seller offered it to me for the price that seemed outrageous at the moment, but I didn't care. I had to have it. I knew that I would need it. No price would compare with the price my teacher would pay. And so I bought it, knowing that whether in life or in death, my beloved friend would need it. And I still can't believe it happened so fast.
Living charity,
A reading now from John 13, verses 3 to 8 and 12 through 16. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus answered him, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." After he had washed their feet, Jesus put on his robe and returned to the table, and he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. And very truly I say to you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them." And now, hearing the voice of Simon Peter.
He continually baffled me. My whole time with him, one surprise after another, Jesus turned my whole world upside down. Especially when it came to relationships. We would worry about who was his right-hand man, and he would always turn it around to one of those first becomes last kind of stories, or last becomes first kind of stories. I wanted to know where I stood with him. I needed him to be my Lord, my guide, my teacher, and he was. But then he went and did this that night. Now, none of us were really of high lineage, but we weren't slaves or servants either. I mean, at the meal that night, where the people would wait on us, this is a service that just comes with any good room rented for a meal. You know, we have people coming in and out. It's no big deal. It just happens that way. But I had planned to wash his feet that night. I was overwhelmed with love for him and fear for his life. I had this nagging need to show him, to demonstrate to him that I would do anything for him. But before I could even begin, he knelt before me. He insisted on washing my feet. I was horrified. I thought maybe I was losing my mind, or maybe he was losing his mind. One more time, he reversed the way I thought things ought to go, and he just kept doing that. It was so frustrating. He said to me, "You can't be a part of the family of God, the kingdom of God, Peter, if you don't let me do this." As if I couldn't see that he really meant what he said about serving our neighbors, our friends, and our enemies. He always kept me off balance. I thought I knew what he meant. And then it seemed like I wasn't getting it. I had to surrender all my preconceived ideas about how relationships are, how they go, and who we love. I had to surrender and let his loving act of washing my feet heal my soul and heal every disappointing relationship I'd ever had.
And so we've heard the words of Peter. And the invitation now is for each of us to enter into this ritual. Leslie is going to wash the feet of Carrie, who is a member of her church, to symbolize for all of us what Jesus did to his disciples. And if we can just watch them as Leslie kneels, as she serves Carrie in this very humble, beautiful way, using water to wash Carrie's feet. Such a simple gesture. And yet, as Jesus did it, it was such a powerful statement of our being called to serve and love each other. And now Leslie will dry Carrie's feet as Jesus dried the feet of the disciples. You can imagine him holding the towel and taking each individual toe and making sure the water was gone from between the toes, and then drying the heel, and how the disciples would have felt their foot being refreshed and alive and clean and blessed. And just the gentle way that Leslie's doing this, I think, can remind us of the gentle way that Jesus must have also done this, with such love, knowing that he was soon to die and that his time with his disciples was coming to a close. And Carrie helping Leslie to her feet, the mutuality of this beautiful moment. And now in your homes, if you have water, I know some of you may have brought water to the service. If not, if you just want to take your hands and symbolically wash your hands as a way to participate in this incredibly simple ritual that Jesus has given to us as a symbol of our call to love each other and to serve each other. So let us simply wash our hands either in water or in the air as a way of receiving this call to be servants in love.
Yes, Lord, and my head also.
All of me. All of me. Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Will you let me be your
It is that time in our service where we have an opportunity to lift up before one another our joys as well as our concerns. We share them, we bear one another's burdens, not just with God, but with one another, because we hold one another in prayer. Feel free to unmute yourselves and speak aloud those things that you have on your heart and mind for which you would like prayer this evening.
The family of Rosemary Almond, as she has passed away earlier today.
Oh. And all the friends for whom she was a very important part of their lives as well, and especially Tammy, her son, her daughter.
And Abby.
I'm not Abby. Abby's been quiet.
Wasn't Abby? Okay.
Abby's been quiet.
Okay.
I'd like to ask for prayers for my roommate Gail, who has been diagnosed with breast cancer.
And I would like to lift up prayers for our friend Patty, who is entering into hospice care.
Reverend Leslie, we need prayers for all of those folks for whom the trial of the police officer in Minneapolis is a traumatic experience, and bringing back traumatic hurts in our hearts.
A joy that Jenny McGuire had her last immunotherapy treatment today.
Prayers for Michael Miller as he continues his chemotherapy and radiation.
Prayers for all of those who have been affected by all of these mass shootings that we've had in the past 2 weeks.
Prayers for remembrance of Chris Almond, Rosemary's son, Rosemary's son, who passed away some time ago and was very close with our family.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Prayers for the loss of voting rights in Georgia.
Prayers in gratitude for the healing power of music in the midst of the suffering and in the midst of the struggle and the hurt, that music can bring such a gift to the spirit.
I'm feeling a little lightheaded, so I'm going to have Carrie do the prayer, and then I'll be right back. Please join me in prayer. We pray the words that Jesus taught us so long ago. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen.
Mm. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. Thy will is my will. Heal me at death so that I may glorify God. Reveal that which needs to be revealed. Heal that which needs to be healed so that I may glorify God. Into thy hands I come. My spirit, thy will is my will. Heal me at death so that I may glorify God. Reveal that which needs to be revealed. Heal that which needs to be healed so that I may.
Is Leslie well enough to return? Carrie?
She's going to sit out for just a little bit. We're getting her something to drink. I'm here to take over if need be.
Okay.
Got to turn the page.
Okay. Is scripture comes next that Leslie was going to read?
All right. I have it here.
Okay. And for those of you who don't know or hadn't heard, Leslie had a root canal today. So she is still coming out of the anesthetic and is not totally 100%. So I think we're concerned, but not overly worried, right? This feels like—
No, she's smiling over here, giving me a thumbs up.
She's gonna be okay, right. Okay, so just wanted to clarify that.
Yes, thank you. All right, I will be reading the scripture from Luke 22, verses 14 through 20. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took a cup and after giving thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Then he took a loaf of bread and thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood.
And so we come to the table. This is the night that Jesus was betrayed, the night that we commemorate every time we share communion. And if you have gathered juice and bread, please at this point have it close to you so we can bless it as the service progresses. And if you have not been able to do that, please join us in spirit, because we know that the bread and the juice are symbols of the presence of the Spirit of God. They are portals and gateways into the mystery of God present within our own hearts, within our communities, and within the expansion of the world herself. And checking in with Carrie, Would you like to participate and do Leslie's part in this?
Yes, I will.
Okay. And again, Leslie's doing okay?
She's good. She's fanning herself.
Okay.
Thanks for being there, Elder Carrie.
Yes, I'm glad I'm here too.
Yes, it's really wonderful that you're able to step in and that your feet were washed. I mean, it just feels like you carry this incredibly powerful symbolism of Maundy Thursday.
Yes.
Yes.
Serve and be served.
Yes. So let us open our hearts to the mystery and the power that is our shared communion. On this night of nights, we are reminded of the story of the meal Jesus shared with his disciples. Long ago, our tradition says, just prior to his arrest, the one we call Jesus took some bread from their common meal, offered a special thanks, and broke it. This bread is broken as my body will be. And he handed it to his friends, inviting them to eat. Remember all that I have been to you. And so tonight, we break the bread, remembering Jesus. This is the bread of life.
And long ago on that same night, our tradition says that also Jesus took a cup and he poured a cup of wine, perhaps the third or fourth cup of a Passover Seder. He offered special thanks for it, Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam. And then he gave it to his friend, and his friends are on that table, the men and women who were the most close disciples that he had. He said, this wine is poured out as my life will be. Remember me and give thanks for all that I have given you. In this tradition, let us also remember and celebrate.
We give thanks for Jesus of Nazareth, gatherer of folk, teller of stories, breaker of bread, pourer of wine, weaver of lives. In his life, wisdom, stories, and social vision, we recall how he spoke to call forth in us love, care, and respect for one another.
And we believe the same Spirit of God that came to visibility in Jesus yearns for visible expression in us.
Loving God, through your goodness, we have this bread and this juice, which earth has given and human hands have made.
Oh God, may we know your presence in the sharing of this bread and this cup.
For these truly are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are now ready.
Let us in our many places receive the gift of God, the bread of life.
We are one in Christ in the bread we share. Take and eat.
We're going to say the next two lines, and then if we can sing that song twice again while people drink the cup and give them some time, that would, or at least one more time, that would be helpful. Let us in our many places receive the gift of God, the cup of blessing.
For we are one in Christ in the cup we share. Take and drink.
Spirit of Christ, you have blessed our tables and our lives. May the eating of this bread give us courage to live out our faith, not only in church sanctuaries, but in your precious world. And may the drinking of this cup renew our hope, even in the midst of pandemic. Wrap your hopeful presence around all whose bodies, spirits, and hearts need healing, and let us become your compassion and safe refuge. Amen.
Sharing paschal bread and wine, as the daylight ebbs away, friends at table join to dine, one of them will soon betray. Beneath a darkening sky, Jesus warns as he foresees, Peter also will deny. Shadows lengthen into night. In the garden still and deep, those he asked to watch and heavy lidded, fall asleep, weary from the anxious day. Shadows lengthen into night. Deeper in the garden's chill, Jesus kneels to pray alone, wrestling with God's holy will. Let it be done. Shadows lengthen into night.
Our service now draws to a close as the evening lengthens into night, as darkness has come into our own homes, into the world around us. So darkness came after the meal, and Jesus went to the garden where he prayed, we are told in scripture, with such intensity, such earnestness, that it was as if blood was dripping from his face and body. He prayed that he could live. He prayed that this cup which he saw coming towards him from the future could be taken away from him. And yet it was tonight when he was able to say in prayer that he would drink that cup. He would follow that way that was laid out for him. And so it is tonight that we leave Jesus in the garden, knowing that Good Friday comes, knowing that the arrest is to come, that the crucifixion is to come. And we invite you to join us again tomorrow night at 7 o'clock as we commemorate Good Friday, as we continue this story, as we move with the energy of this Holy Week ever closer and closer to the crucifixion and ever closer and closer to the beauty and the mystery that is Easter. And so we hope you will join us through the same Zoom link tomorrow night at the same time. Blessings. Good night.